ओके ऑलराइट, सो थोड़ा नीचे लगाते हैं. सो होपफुली द टी वाज अ लिटिल और कॉफी वाज अ लिटिल रिफ्रेशर. यू हैड लिटिल शुगर टू गो फॉर नेक्स्ट वन एंड हाफ आवर सेशन. दिस सेशन इज गोइंग टू बी अबाउट मिलिंग. आई ऑलरेडी सेड अर्लियर, इफ यू थॉट टर्निंग वाज और ऑब्लिक वाज डिफिकल्ट, दिस इज गोइंग टू बी परहैप्स अ लिटिल मोर इंटरेस्टिंग. So I'll try and keep it simple. If you have any questions, please feel free to stop me. The purpose of this exercise is to try and explain to you how this works. Yeah? And this might be new for most of you. Has anybody dealt with milling processes in the past? Simulation, modeling? Has anybody done that? No. Yeah. So this is going to be new. You have. Oh, so you're exception to the rule. So maybe you can help us. So this is going to be new for everybody, and I have tried to schedule and structure the presentation such that we have videos every 15-20 minutes, so that if you're feeling sleepy, we can motivate you back to wake up. Okay, there is some issue with this. So give us a minute till we set up. Okay, so milling is a very different animal compared to turning. Primarily it is multi-point cutting. Turning is or oblique or what you saw till now was single point cutting. This is going to be multi-point. And multi-point cutting may there are a lot of complexities which some of them will address. Feel free to stop me, I already told you, right? Any questions, we'll have a discussion. Where does this fit into our scheme of things? Yeah, I think I showed this to you in the morning also. So this is just to review that. There are three inputs that we want to put into a process machine interaction model. Our objective is to get stability lobe diagrams, and then which will guide cutting conditions and always result in stable cutting. So that is our major objective. But input into that is a machining process model. So we've done orthogonal, we did a little of oblique, but now we'll talk about milling. So we'll talk about machining models for milling. We'll talk about how different tools influence machining models for milling, and dynamics we'll leave for tomorrow. So today we'll talk about machining models and how tools impact machining process models for milling. Okay, so milling. So there is turning, boring, drilling, sawing, reaming, broaching. I don't know what else can you think of. But out of all these processes, milling makes up about 85% of all the machining that we do. And still for some reason we don't teach milling properly. In all our machining process courses that we teach, we leave milling out because it's difficult. But I'll try and simplify it. Our objective is to motivate that because it makes up 85% of all machining operations, if you don't study milling, you've not studied machining. So let's try and do some milling. The objectives of milling, I think Dr. Chaudhary already spoke about this in the morning, is if you're able to predict forces, from forces you can predict torque, from torque you can predict power consumption. From power consumption you can then select which machine you need to use. What spindle power do you need to do a particular operation? From forces you can also try and select if the tool is right for this kind of application. That is also one of the objectives for milling process modeling. So it's predicting forces, is size tools and machines, so selection of different machines and tools. And more importantly for us, because we're looking at process machine interactions, is to identify these cutting force coefficients which we briefly spoke about before the break. For milling, because these give you a sense of machinability. Machinability is this term that some of you might have heard of. Has anybody heard of machinability? Show of hands, have you heard of it? So this is a very loose term. It means different thing for different people. So we will define machinability for our purpose as something that will make it easy to cut. And it can be lesser forces, it can be lesser torque, it can be lesser power. So for us, machinability is something that makes things easier to cut. And how do you get a sense of machinability is by a force model. In a force model, you need these coefficients, which we will show you how to identify tomorrow. Today we'll just use them. We already spoke a little about this. If you don't simulate the process, you cannot simulate a toolpath. You will not know what kind of cutting parameters to use. So another objective of milling process modeling is selection or design of toolpath, selection of cutting parameters. Diagnostics, very important. How does the tool wear? How does it affect surface quality? And you can do this through process simulation, and we'll talk a little about this also. Product design, so if you know how forces are acting on a tool or on a workpiece, you can help design perhaps a better tool to reduce the forces. You can help also perhaps help design a better machine, but that's also one of the objectives of this. And of course, our objective, the grander objective, is predict and avoid chatter vibrations, for which you need a process model for milling. So this is the objective, and to meet that objective, this is the outline of this talk. So we'll talk, I'll introduce milling processes just broadly. We'll talk about mechanics of face milling, mechanics of helical end milling. These are the two most common milling operations. And then we'll do some case studies, some simulation on MATLAB to show you what happens and how to simulate these, how to write codes, and so on. And this can be an interactive session at the end. Oh, so neural network is a very fancy term. It means what? Machine learning. It's machine learning is you take data, you learn, and then you fit a curve to it to see what is happening. So it's black box modeling. You don't know what is happening. Our approach is physics-based modeling. What is the physics? How does the chip form? How does the force generate because of chip formation? Of course, there are a lot of models which learn on their own. But that is not our purpose. Our purpose is physics based. What is the physical mechanism which is causing a chip to form? So that is the kind of models we'll talk about. Okay, so milling, I don't know if everybody can see this clearly. There is a range of operations. There is face milling. There is slotting. There is slitting. There is a slitting cutter uske niche. This is also a face mill. This is also a face mill. This is a profiling cutter. This is an end mill, solid carbide. This is a end mill with indexable inserts along the periphery. This is a plunging cutter. All this falls under milling. And of course, many more. This is just a broad classification. So there are two types, essentially. Solid carbide, where your entire tool body is made of solid carbide. And then you have another type, where you have a steel body, and you have indexable inserts, so cutting inserts, along the periphery to cut. Face mills are typically with inserts, and end mills are typically with solid body. It can also be with carbide, with indexable inserts. Each of these operations you can do on a vertical machining center or a horizontal machining center. So vertical machining center mein spindle is vertical, horizontal mein spindle is horizontal. So this is just the kind of operations you can do, the kind of cutters you will use with that, and the kind of machines to go with that. Our focus is face milling and end milling, two most commonly used. Okay, so that is what I said. Face milling. So there is a nice video you can see on that top left. It is showing you, it is playing, which is nice. It is showing you how the cutter is rotating as well as feeding along a tool path, and the chips are getting formed. And it's a nice, lovely process. It's again high-speed imaging. So, and then it is slowed down to show you how it really looks. So it's a fairly complicated process. You can see there are multiple teeth in cut. It's not like that one point in single turning. So if you look at this cutter geometry, so this is the front view or side view. This is the bottom view, and then this is the top view. So if you look at the front or the side view, there are inserts along the periphery. And they make some angles. So there is the common, so here also we have different kind of rake angles. There is an axial rake, which makes as in the angle along the vertical Z axis, and the insert face is called the axial rake. There is a radial rake. So when you look at this view, what angle does the insert make with respect to this axis here? So there's a radial rake, there's the axial rake, and there's something called a lead angle. So three important angles in milling. all these inserts that you have are normally adjustable radially. Yeah. So you can move them in and out, left and right, using wedges. Yeah. And this is for a purpose, but we'll talk about that later. So this is just a schematic of how the cutter looks. Different inserts along the periphery, each which you can adjust, and they all form different angles. If you look at the top view, this is face milling. Yeah? So the workpiece is feeding into the cutter and the cutter is rotating. So this is how the mechanism of is taking place. This is a schematic of exactly what is happening here. Yeah? So if you see the schematic, yeah, there is the circle that you see here represents the cutter. It's a schematic. This is one tooth out of the many that is in on the cutter. This is one tooth. Yeah? This is the width of cut. This is how it is feeding. Yeah? So the milling cutter is rotating as well as feeding at the same time. Yeah? So you can see that the chip generation or chip formation mechanism is no longer as simple as it was in turning. So I'll go back to turning. So in turning, this was your tool. Yeah? And this is, now we will use a different terminology than Dr. Chaudhary used. Yeah? Okay, so it might be confusing, but we'll try and keep you with it. Yeah? This is H, chip thickness. Yeah? He called it T1. Yeah? There is a standard rake angle and the clearance angle. Yeah? What is important is this. Can you see this? Or is it hidden behind the... Can everybody see this? So this is H, yeah? Chip thickness, what Dr. Chaudhary was calling H1. Here you can see that chip thickness is not constant, and we'll talk about why and how. Yeah? Okay, so if you can see what is happening here, yeah, is as this tool is rotating, so this tool is rotating and feeding. The feeding action is C. Yeah? So C is the feed rate in millimeter per revolution per tooth. Multiple teeth in cut, looking at only one tooth right now. Yeah? So what you can see is, I will sketch this, yeah, but I'll try and explain it to you first on this schematic. So C is how much you advance the cutter while it is rotating. Because you're advancing the cutter while it is rotating, the cutter comes into contact, this is the workpiece, yeah? It comes into contact at what we call the phi start, which is the entry angle of cutting. Yeah? So the phi start is the entry angle for cutting. Phi exit is when the cutter exits. Phi is the current engagement, current position of the cutter. Yeah? So what you can see very clearly that as it advances and rotates, the chip is a function of phi, yeah, of this. So if we try and sketch how this chip looks like, I don't know if it's clear here, but so this is our tool. Yeah? This is an insert here, or a cutting tooth. So, and I'm now going to sketch what is happening in this rotation and then over here. So, we'll call this 0. This is 90 degrees. This is, of course, 180. Yeah? So, between 0 and 90, yeah, your chip thickness is something like this. So, this is your chip thickness. Yeah? You're advancing the cutter and you're rotating it at the same time. So you can see that it is changing as a function of this angle. So this angle is phi. Yeah? So phi is, we define, yeah, so phi is here, right? This angle. So this is when it is between 0 and 90. If you consider between 90 and 180, the chip thickness profile is something like this. So this is between 90 and 180. Again, it's a function of phi, yeah? Where phi is this. No, so this is very interesting. Yeah. So it's entering and exiting. So this is face milling. You might have heard of up and down milling. Yeah? So in up milling, the chip gradually increases. In down milling, it gradually reduces. So in face milling, we have a combination of up milling and down milling. We'll talk a little about that later. So it, So it is upmilling in the first half, and here it is reducing. So that's why the chip is now constantly changing. Is everybody understanding that? Yeah? In turning, it was constant. H is constant. Here, I'll show you how it is changing, but H is a function of what we call engagement. Yeah? Is that clear? This is a very important concept. Yeah? This is not clear. The rest of it will be confusing. So any question, let's stop and understand, address. Okay, good. So to repeat, the tool is rotating and advancing. C is the feed, how much you advance. And phi is the engagement. Phi start is when it comes into contact. And phi exit is when it exits the workpiece. So essentially three angles. Phi is the instantaneous engagement angle. Starting is when it starts, and exit is when it exits. Now you can see, very important assumption in face milling. Yeah? In face milling, I'll go back here. You can see that these inserts have no helix. In most cases, this is true. In some cases, you also have an insert which has a helix. So it's got a spiral. But in most cases, the insert is flat. So the helix angle is zero. This is very important in face milling, yeah, in how you build the model. So the helix angle that we say is zero. Yeah? B is the width of cut, and A is the actual depth of cut, which is inside the plane of this board. Yeah? So A is deep, B is wide. Okay, so, all right. This is how the chip thickness varies. I already told you, in turning it is constant, H. Here, it is a function of the instantaneous angle of engagement. So wherever this cutter is, this will keep changing, right? And this can change from, say, 0 degrees to all the way 180. Yeah? It cannot be more than that. Yeah? It can only cut on one side, not at the back. Yeah? So it's always between 0 and 180. So you can see that it is continuously varying periodically as a function of the engagement angle as well as the feed. Yeah? So this distance here is the feed, yeah? And this is the engagement. Clear? Okay. All right. Now, this is only the instantaneous chip thickness, this one here. If you want, you can also calculate the average chip thickness per revolution. So what you can do, very simply, integrate between these limits. So phi start and phi exit, and that will give you the average chip thickness. We are not so much interested in average. Yeah? Some models use an average approach, which is an approximation, but we are more interested in seeing how it evolves as a function of time or rotation or engagement. So that is our objective. Yeah? So this one is very simple. We'll skip. We'll stick with the more fundamental one, which is giving you a function of engagement. All right, any question there? Okay.
So we'll take H5 in the radial direction.
Sorry?
Chip thickness would take in the radial direction.
H5? Yeah.
I mean chip thickness H.
So if you mean this is radial direction?
No, not exactly.
What do you mean radial direction? This is the plane of cut. Okay. The chip thickness is in the plane of cut. So in orthogonal, you can see where the chip thickness there is, right? It's in the plane of cut. Are you seeing this here? So this is in the plane of cut. Similarly, the chip thickness is in the plane of cut. Yeah? It's varying continuously as a function of engagement. It changes as a function of radial, yeah? Radial immersion. We call it immersion. So it's actually changing, it's not constant. Yeah? It's changing, it's in the radial immersion plane. So I don't know if that answers your question. But don't think radial. Yeah? Think changing, because that's what is happening. Okay. Anything else? All right, so let's move on. Yeah? So average is you're integrating how it is changing between the starting and the ending point. Yeah? So you would just want to see how the integration limits are start and end. Yeah? And this is nothing but you already saw here. And DeFi is because you're integrating it over some elemental area or elemental advance. Yes? So this is just the average chip thickness. If you're interested in calculating it, we're actually not interested in it. Yeah? It's just given there because some models use average chip thickness approach, which is to my, as in it's an approximation, it works, but we're interested in instantaneous chip thickness. No, yeah. Feed per tooth is only C. Yeah. C is your feed rate per tooth. Yeah. It's C into a function of the engagement. Yeah. And it's sinusoidally changing. So it's starting at, if you calculate, it's just simply a geometric transformation. It's a function of sine. Yeah. So C is that first term here. C into sine of phi. Yeah. And that's important. Yeah. So if it is only C, then it's constant. What we are trying? Huh? Always in radian. Always in radian. You can always do back and forth. You can work in both domains. But for our purpose, let's keep it in radian.
Speed is no parameter.
Chip thickness may speed.
Like high speed delay operation.
Yeah, as in speed will not determine feed. We are talking about chip thickness, which is a function of feed. Speed is very different. Yeah. Speed doesn't determine how the chip thickness changes. We'll come to speed parameter later. Here we're just seeing how it is changing as a function of engagement.
So feed per revolution is a function of the speed.
It's actually millimeter per tooth. Yeah. It's millimeter per tooth. We call it revolution per. So for example, in feed in milling or feed in turning, yeah, this is your workpiece. Yeah, this is your tool. So this is a rotating workpiece. This is your tool. You give a feed in millimeter per revolution. So per rotation of your workpiece in turning, you say advance your tool by so much feed, right? And feed in turning is nothing but H. Hmm? So feed in turning is H. Feed in milling is you're rotating and how much you advance per tooth. Feed in millimeter per minute is different. You're thinking millimeter per minute, right?
No, it's correct. Revolution, we're considering the speed of the spindle.
No, let me explain this. Because if we get stuck here, we'll not be able to go ahead. So feed in millimeter per minute. This is what you give your NC code, right? How much feed to move. This is a function of feed per tooth into number of teeth into speed, where speed is in RPM. Okay. Right now we are talking about this, feet per tooth. You see units, millimeter per tooth into number of teeth into RPM will give you millimeter per minute. Yeah? So dimensionally also it makes sense. We are talking now right now of this feed, where FT is nothing but your C. Okay. No chip thickness ratio. Now if you're in milling. Okay. Very different domain. How will you calculate chip thickness ratio? It's continuously changing. Kaise calculate karoge? In turning it's constant. Or we assume it's constant. Static model. Yeah? Even this is a static model. But because it's varying as a function of engagement, you cannot calculate chip thickness ratio. Because input-output relation, how will you get? You had another question.
So here assumption feed is very less or negligible as comparison.
No.
Because if feed is more,
yes,
then profile would be elliptical.
Actually, it is. Yeah, you're right. So what we are assuming is that this advances in circles. Yeah? It's actually not elliptical. It's like a cycloidal profile. So we make a very big assumption, yeah, that in every feed, in every C, so every C, it moves one circle ahead. So we get a nice profile. Yeah?
Practically, it won't be
there. No, you can, practically you're right. The
if feed is less, then only you can
say. Actually, no, this is a very reasonable approximation. What you're talking about is an exact kinematic model, yeah, because this is a kinematic problem. how does it move? No. So kinematics is just motion, right? So you can generate a more exact kinematic model. They exist, yeah. But we are talking about an approximate model, and because this is the basis to understand. If you understand this, you can build an exact kinematic model. As in, it's already been built maybe 3-4 decades ago. So it's not new, it exists. But this is a good base to understand and approximate how it works. Yeah? Our kinematical friends have some questions? Yes.
I think these two at a time, I think milling happen, up milling and down milling.
Always.
Because only the water circle of it will be engaged.
No. So it depends on entry and exit angle. Yeah. So.
But the peak rate, mm per revolution per tool, just imagine the angle while the cutting insert is in exactly in x axis or 0 degree.
Yeah, so. No, it's already being fed. Yeah. Instantaneously it is at 90 degrees.
Yeah,
0 degrees is why?
Maximum at the entrance and minimum at the exit.
No. It's up milling and then down milling.
No, if that be the case, then it should be more. If I'm doing only up milling, then I will get a bigger profile on the bottom.
This one?
On the bottom side.
This one?
And I'm doing down milling and still feeding it.
Yes.
Still feeding it.
Yeah. Because we are approximating the kinematics. We are saying that it is advancing by one circle.
Okay, that is an approximation.
It's approximating the kinematics. The real kinematics are different, you're right. Yeah. But we are approximating the kinematics.
Yeah. Yes, actually the feet per tooth is 1 mm.
Yes, okay. 1 mm is very big.
Yeah, yeah, like,
0.1.
For understanding,
okay.
1 mm. So at the starting, when yes. The tool engages, it is 0.
Hmm.
Okay. So it gradually increases and when it exits, so it is 1 mm.
Yes. No. It's sine. No. Let's see. Let's take values for sine. Yeah? Sine 0 is what? 0. Yeah? Sine 180 is also 0. Yeah? And this is the function of sine. Yeah? So you're right. At entry, the feed is not advancing. So chip thickness is 0. You can see that here. Right? No, it's an approximation of the kinematics. The exact kinematics are more difficult. If you understand this, then you can understand that. So let's first treat the basic fundamental kinematics. But think of it here, geometry. Sine 0 is 0, sine 180 is also 0. That's why chip thickness is 0 at entry and 0 at exit. Any questions? Okay, so that took a lot of time, but important. Okay, so this is up milling, down milling. This answers your question. Up milling, down milling, isko dekh lo abhi. Okay, I don't know if it's clear. So this is up milling. Yeah? Direction of rotation and direction of feed are opposite. Yeah? So this is the direction of rotation of the cutter. This is the engagement. Yeah? So engagement, ab dekhoge, B is again the width. Yeah? Entry angle is 0. Right? We always start entry angle along the y-axis. Yeah? This is the y, this is the x. Entry angle is 0, exit angle through geometry we can calculate, very simply. Yeah? And we can get phi start and phi exit in up milling. Similarly in down milling, yeah? Now in down milling the feed direction and direction of rotation are the same. So the entry angle here is not 0, right? This is down milling, entry angle is already, in this case it is 90 degrees. Here depending on engagement, so depending on B, it will be, you can calculate it through geometry. This case, what we are assuming is this. Yeah? We are creating a, this is a workpiece. Yeah? Not this, this is the workpiece. Yeah? In this case, we are assuming that it starts cutting here and exits here and we are making a slot. This is slotting. So this is, in slotting it is 0, 90, 90, 180. But it can be any arbitrary engagement, right? It can be 25% of the diameter, 50% of the diameter, 10%. Yeah? So radial engagement, jo kehte hain. So it can be any arbitrary engagement. So you can calculate this entry and exit angle for any arbitrary engagement depending on up and down. This is a very simple geometric trigonometric relationship. Yeah? This is important, yeah, because up milling, down milling are actually quite different. And the although the process of chip formation is essentially the same, for different purposes you use different application. For example, a lot of people might tell you, and there is some truth to it, that up milling makes sense when you're doing very heavy duty cutting, because the chip load is gradually increasing. So it makes sense in terms of loading the cutter. It's not immediately impact. Whereas in down milling, you'll see the highest chip is at the entry. So it's like an impact. So up milling is generally preferred in roughing applications because it's gradual engagement. And down milling in finishing applications, where the depth of cut is lesser. So even if you start with a big chip engagement, it does not damage so many things. But it depends, yeah? Which one to use, yeah? In fact, stability from chatter viewpoint, we cannot tell you which is better because both are different. And sometimes up milling might make sense, sometimes down milling might make sense. So my point is they're both different, but what is important is only the entry and exit angle that makes it different. This is the only information you need to carry forward. What is the entry angle? What is the exit angle? And it's different for up milling, different for down milling. And we can get simply through geometry. Yeah? All right, any question there? No? Okay. All right, so let's come back now. Yeah? So this is again the schematic that we showed you. We're assuming only one tooth in cut, so single point. Yeah? There'll actually be multiple teeth, we'll talk about that later. So this red thing represents one tooth in cut at an engagement angle of phi. Entry angle is phi start and exit is phi exit. Yeah? The forces at the tool, yeah? So there are two forces. There is the tangential force acting at the tool. This is the xy plane, you can see that, right? X and y. There is a tangential force acting at the tool and a radial force also acting at the tool point. There'll also be an axial force. Yeah? But milling mein jyada axial force nahi in face milling because there's no helix. So axial force is negligible, but it's still there. But what we can do is we can resolve. So if you remember turning, let's talk about turning now. We have to keep going back and forth, yeah, between turning and milling, so that there is continuity in your understanding. Yeah? So in turning, if you remember, this is the tool. And this is your chip thickness that you're forming. Yeah? So there are two forces that we showed earlier acting, right? There is a force here and there is a force here. This is the, we call tangential force, here we call feed force. Yeah? This is the feeding direction, this is the tangential direction. In milling, there are three force components. There is tangential, acting at the tooth, radial as well as axial. Understanding? Yeah. What we can do is we can resolve these forces into x and y directions. And we'll talk about why. Yeah. So what you've simply done here is we can talk about how. So this is x, this is y. Yeah. Your tooth is over here. There is a tangential force on the tooth, Ft, and then there is a radial component on the tooth, right? And this is at some angle, this is angle is phi, yeah? Right? So through simple geometry, trigonometric transformation, what you can do is you can assume this force to be acting here, yeah? This force is here, Fr, this is Ft. These are opposite angles. This becomes phi. This angle will also become phi. And now you can resolve forces. So this direction is here and this direction is here. You can see if you want forces in F direction, in x direction, it'll be minus Ft cos phi, yeah? And minus Fr sine phi. That is clear? And similarly, for y direction, it will be ft sin phi minus fr cos phi, वही है ना? हाँ, okay. So this is what we've done. We've taken forces acting at the tool, which are tangential and radial, and resolve them into the x and the y direction. Because, as in all forces, as in the world has Cartesian coordinates for our understanding. Tangential, radial, axial is on the tool, but for our understanding, it works best in Cartesian x, y, z coordinates, because these are the forces that you will also measure. You can't measure tangential. What is tangential? It's nice over there, but you can't measure it. You will measure x, y, z. That is why we are resolving this. Okay, any question here? Okay, so we've resolved these forces. Now let's look at how we convert these forces to tangential, radial, and axial. Okay, now this is the equation we already spoke about earlier. You remember this? And why we have a simplified form of this equation instead of all those angles, geometry, shear angle, obliquity. This is all oblique. Milling is an oblique cutting process. This is not orthogonal.
And the phi there is different from this
one? No, same phi. Same phi. No, this is h phi. If you remember, we wrote h phi. Yes, remember, that's a very important equation. So that is why it's a function of phi. In turning, there was no phi because it's constant. Only difference between turning and milling is this phi here. No. Helix, there is zero helix. Zero helix. Helix will come in end milling. We'll talk about that later. Phi is angle of engagement. Ye wala jo phi hai na. Hai to sahi. This is phi. Ye jo angle hai. Okay. Instantaneous engagement angle. How the tooth is in cut. So this form you've already seen. KTC, KRC, KAC are tangential, radial, and axial cutting force coefficients. Now, let's do a dimensional analysis for this. So, can we? Forces in Newton. A is the depth of cut, also millimeter. H is what unit? Yeah, but what unit is it? Millimeter. Millimeter. Okay, so what should be the units for KTC? This is Newton per millimeter square. So please remember this. This is very important. It's called a specific cutting force coefficient, or specific cutting force pressure, or specific constant, cutting constant. There are different terminologies. It has units of Newton per millimeter square. And you can see how. This is a specific cutting constant. This KTE, KRE, KAE are edge coefficients or rubbing coefficients. So even when you have no chip thickness, you're just in contact with the workpiece and you're running the tool, there will be some rubbing, there will be some plowing. So these are those terms, KTE, KRE. So let's do an example actually. So let's assume turning. And what I'm going to do on the x-axis, I'm going to put discrete values of feed, chip thickness, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, and so on. On the y-axis, I'm measuring force. Can you see this? So I get one data point. At this feed rate, there is some force. At another feed rate, there's another data point, right? When there is zero feed, what will be the force? Will it be zero or will it be? So there is a non-zero, this is what we call rubbing. When there is a zero feed, or zero chip thickness, it will always be rubbing. So there has to be a force. So that is at zero intercept. When x is 0, the y-intercept is called rubbing. So that rubbing we capture in a coefficient, which we call the edge coefficient or rubbing coefficient or plowing coefficient, whatever you want to call it. Yeah. It has different units, you can now see. Yeah. Is Newton per millimeter. Okay, so again to reiterate, we have tangential and radial forces. You resolve them into x, y, z as a very simple transformation. Each of these Ft and Fr we can describe using cutting force coefficients, radial, axial, tangential. How do we get these cutting coefficients is another matter. So what we will do is we will tomorrow identify them. There is a systematic method to do it. So in the afternoon tomorrow first we will explain to you how to identify it, and then we will go to the machine and measure and then get these coefficients. Yeah? That is one way. Second is you can do a transformation from orthogonal to oblique. There's a lot of math involved in that in the background, which we will skip. But there are two ways to get this. You saw those nice fancy equations that Dr. Chaudhary showed you earlier, right? A function of shear stress, a function of B, T, and all those five different angles. Yeah? So if you have that information, you can transform from there as an orthogonal to oblique. You can also get this for this kind of tool geometry. But it's always easier and best to identify this coefficient for a given tool, for a given workpiece, for a given geometry. And you can see, if you get this coefficient, this gives you a sense of the force levels that you will get in machining. And that is why this helps you define machinability. Are you seeing how this is coming together? We want to define machinability. Yeah? So if you get a coefficient like this, you can then predict the force. B and H you define, right? Actual depth of cut you say 2 millimeter, feed you say 0.1 millimeter. You can predict what FT will be. So you can see what, for this material, what the force profile will be. From forces, now we'll see what we do next. Okay, another very important information. Any questions here? Yes, this, in fact, this coefficient is valid only for a given set of cutting conditions. If you will add, if you will change the tool material, you will put coating on the tool, you will change the workpiece material, you will identify this at different machines, yeah, it will be different. Whether you use coolant or lubrication or not, it will be different. Yeah. So this changes, this is the only for a specific combination of tool geometry, tool, workpiece combination. Okay. Yes, that's what I said. There are two ways to get these coefficients. Eh? If you get them in orthogonal, you can transform them to orthogonal to oblique using that big equation that Dr. Chaudhary showed. If you have all those angles, but how will you get the shear angle? You're still stuck, right? So either you do orthogonal cutting tests, you get that shear angle, and then you use that big fancy equation, you transform, and you get this. Or simpler, you do cutting tests directly for this, because this is what you want to use. So instead of going to orthogonal, then doing orthogonal to oblique transformation, yeah, directly if you want to cut this material with this kind of tool, you do these kind of cutting tests and identify it. Okay, even that is valid. Yeah? You can do orthogonal and then transform. But for that you need shear angle. Okay, another important point, yeah, is this. Forces are active, yeah, only when the tooth is in cut. So between phi start and phi exit, yeah, you can see that condition here. Yeah. When that tooth is between phi start and phi exit is when there will be forces acting on that tooth, because that is when it is cutting. When it is here, for example, it is not in contact, so force is zero. Yeah. And that is why this becomes very interesting, milling. It's called interrupted cutting. And it's interrupted cutting because sometimes a tooth is in cut, sometimes it is out of cut. Whereas turning is always in, as in turning is always in contact, so it's continuous cutting. But this is interrupted. Understanding that? Yeah? Okay, several new ideas we have come across. Yeah? So most importantly, chip thickness changes the function of engagement. And you can resolve that into x, y, z, get ft, fr, fa, yeah, axial, tangential, radial. And remember that it is interrupted. So this is a single point. There are actually multiple teeth on that milling cutter, yeah, like we showed you earlier. So what happens when you have multiple teeth in cut? Now imagine there is not one, but there is another one over here, yeah, which is in the cut at the same time as the first one. So there is something called pitch. For example, if you have a face mill with four teeth, yeah, the pitch is what? Exactly. So this is 5p is 2 pi, 360 divided by number of teeth. That gives you the pitch of the cutter. Now when the swept angle, this is a swept angle, which is the angle difference between exit and start, yeah, when that angle is greater than the pitch angle, there will be multiple teeth in cut. Yeah. Are you understanding? Yeah. So for example, if this angle is going to be 120 degrees and the pitch is 90 degrees, there will be two teeth in cut. At any given time, there will always be two teeth in cut. And because there is more than one tooth in cut, yeah, the forces acting on each tool become important. So it's no longer one tooth. Yeah. There are forces acting on two teeth simultaneously. So chip generation is different for each tooth. Because if you go back, yeah, this is for one tooth. H for one tooth. Second tooth ka H is different. So what happens is the force becomes then a summation of all the forces acting on all teeth in cut at that instant as a function of engagement. Complicated? We haven't got to helical end milling. That is even more interesting. Yeah? This is only face milling. Yeah? Okay, anyway, so we can sum the forces on each tooth. Yeah? So this is what this is saying. J is the tooth. Yeah? Phi J is for that specific tooth. J, the subscript J, from 1 to NT. So first tooth to number of teeth. So the subscript J is for tooth number, tooth counter. Q is nothing but x, y, z. So each one you will have different. X, y, z, you need to sum all of them. Okay, so if we can get forces, Dr. Chaudhary spoke about resultant forces and why they are important. We can very simply get a resultant force, which is a summation of x, y, and z. Instantaneous resultant force. Remember, it keeps changing as a function of engagement. Yeah? And engagement, and you sum them over all the teeth that are in cut, multiple point cutting. If you can get resultant force, then you can get instantaneous torque on the spindle.
Engagement depends upon the teeth generally also.
Yes.
So if you take unsymmetrical combination.
Forget unsymmetrical. Take a helix. If you take a helix, which is the next slide, we'll come to that. If you take a helix, it's going to be different. Engagement is going to be different along the helix. Because why is it? I didn't understand. Symmetrical in what sense? What do you mean?
Angles involved in the individual teeth geometry. So you are taking symmetrical na combination, what are the...
So you mean the relief angle, clearance angle, helix angle, not helix, so rake angles?
Yeah.
Oh, I think mostly for all cutters, milling cutters, each tooth has the same geometry. Yeah? I don't think they vary. Kinometal people can tell us. Yeah? Do you vary insert geometry on every insert on a face mill? No. Helical, let's not talk about helical right now. No, rake angle is the same. Helical, chhod do. Helical will come to later. Yeah? Helical, yes. But if you see, these kind of cutters we showed you earlier. Ye jo cutter hai, the geometry on each of this is the same. Yeah, so engagement is going to be similar depending on where it is in the cut. If the geometry of each insert is different, it will be different. But I don't think people use different geometry. I'll be surprised if they do. Yeah. Helical, yes, we'll talk about that, but otherwise, no. Okay. All right, so we were at resultant forces we got. We got instantaneous torque, yeah, because we know tangential, d is the diameter, we can get the instantaneous torque. If you remember, our objective for milling process modeling was to predict forces. From forces you get torque, from torque you get power. And if you have power, you can then decide what kind of spindle motor you need to use. That was our initial for objective. So you see, we've kind of done that. We've jumped a lot of steps. We've tried to make simplifying assumptions. But the idea was to try and motivate that engagement changes as a function of chip thickness changes as a function of engagement. There are multiple teeth in cut. It's an interrupted cutting process. And it's very different than turning. So if you have torque, from torque you also have the cutting force Ft, tangential force. V is nothing but your cutting speed. You can get power. So in a way we've come full circle. So now if you give me the cutting force coefficient for a material, yeah, and you ask me to predict what kind of forces will come, I will ask you what is your depth of cut, what is your engagement, what your B is. Yeah. If you give me these two parameters, I can predict the force, I can predict the torque, I can also predict power. And I can tell you, for this kind of operation, if you want to cut titanium at 2 millimeter depth of cut, you will need a machine with this kind of power. Right? So this is one objective. Any questions so far? No, we are summing them over all teeth. Yeah.
All the teeth of cutter.
So only when the tooth is in contact. There's the condition, right? The condition, if you remember the earlier slide, this is the condition. Only when the tooth is in contact is the force active. Yeah. Now, at any given time, there can be more than one tooth in contact, yeah, which was this condition. Yeah. If you're understanding, yeah, if difference between entry and exit is greater than pitch, if 120 is greater than 90, which is the pitch, there'll be two teeth. So you have to sum the contribution of each tooth to get the full complete force, and which keeps changing as a function of rotation. So this becomes very interesting to solve and to do this.
When we calculate forces, it's instantaneous at that particular
at that point.
At that angle.
At that angle, yes.
But normal, when I want to pick a spindle part.
Yes. Yes.
The double tooth, how would I, where will I pick, what motor would I pick?
So no, so
for every angle the motor is different.
No. For every material, cutting parameters, your force level will be different. You remember, see, forces here are a function of
h of phi is c.
Yes, yeah.
So for each phi, my force is different. Since force
it keeps changing, yes.
Changing.
But you have to keep summing it. So as it goes across 0 to 90, yeah, what is it at 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree, you have to calculate. You can't just calculate at 0 degree and 90 degree. You want to see how it is evolving. So in fact, this is a very interesting question. So we spoke about upmilling and downmilling, right? So let's look at force profile. So this is upmilling, yeah? Chip thickness increasing. This is downmilling, chip thickness reducing. So just keep these things in mind, and let's look at force profile for both these. Yeah? So we'll do first upmilling. If you remember upmilling, now if I draw the force profile as a function of time or phi. Lakshmikant, this is an answer to your question.
Yeah.
Okay, this is force. Chip thickness is changing. So the force will actually increase and fall, and increase and fall. Yeah? In down milling, so this is down milling now. Hmm? The force profile will be so it's changing instantaneously as a function of time or engagement. That is what we want to get. Yeah? If you only solve it at 0 degree and at 90 degree, you will just get these two data points. How do you know what the maximum is? It depends on engagement, right? Because you are assuming that it is 90 degrees. What if it is just 30 degrees, between 0 and 30? You'll have to calculate h c sine 30, then put that into this formula for a given axial depth of cut, for a different given workpiece coefficient, predict what this is, then resolve them in x, y, z, then sum over each tooth. Yeah? So this is a lot of steps to do. We'll do this. We'll do this right now.
Generally, single tooth in contact result in vibration.
Yes, it's impact. So imagine this. If you take, we'll talk about this tomorrow morning actually, but if you take a ruler or a scale, you keep it here and you impact it, it's going to vibrate. Milling is like that, yeah? Each time the tooth comes into contact, it's an impact. It makes the system vibrate. And that is why milling is very interesting. Chatter and milling is very different and difficult as compared to chatter and turning, because it's interrupted. So every time the tooth comes into contact, it's an impact, it makes it vibrate. New tooth comes into contact, it again hits it, again makes it vibrate. Third tooth comes, fourth tooth comes. So each time it's getting excited. So we'll talk about this later, but it is an impact. Milling is impact loading. You can see it's 0 to immediately jumps and then gradually reduces.
In general, for milling, I guess probably can other guys can help. But you normally use a single point cut only during finish.
In milling?
Milling.
Never.
No?
Milling is multiple point
final,
cutting.
Final cut on.
So your parameters might be conservative. You
yeah.
will become less depth of cut.
That's a finish machining. I would have already done two passes. The third pass would be single point.
No. No. Your parameters will be conservative. So your speed, feed, depth of cut will be different for finish machining than for rough machining. Hmm? It's never single point cutting. Hmm? You agree?
No?
Yeah, he agrees. Yeah. Okay. Anything else? Yeah? So this was face milling. Yeah? Now we'll go to helical end milling, which is more interesting. Okay, let's jump. Yeah? Okay, this is a nice video. I told you every 20 minutes I'll try and have a video. Yeah? So people who are sleeping will wake you up. Yeah? People who are not will get more interested. So this is helical end milling. This is an end mill with three flutes, you can see. It is not cutting yet, but over time you will see some chips forming. And you can see what is interesting here is there is a helix. Is that clear to everybody? So in face milling, there was no helix. If you remember, the tooth was straight. Now there is a helix, and helix complicates things and makes them more interesting. And we'll see how. Yeah. Okay, so this is how it makes things interesting. So this is a schematic of a helical end mill. So you can see that these are the teeth, and the teeth have an helix on them, and these are the flutes in the middle so that the chip that you generate gets evacuated. Yeah? So teeth, multiple teeth on the periphery, again multiple point cutting. This is a solid carbide end mill, or solid HSS, high speed steel end mill. Inserted will be different, but similar mechanics. So these are the teeth, multiple teeth along the periphery. And what is interesting is they're all, again, there's a pitch, which we already discussed. For example, this is a four teeth cutter. If it is, the pitch will be 90 degrees. So phi p is the pitch. Yeah? A is the axial depth of cut. Yeah? And psi is a lead angle or lag angle. I think somebody mentioned here. Yeah? So what is good about helical milling, yeah, or helical end milling is that this chip, the chip generation is gradual. So you can see it will change from when the tool is at the bottom to when this tooth goes all the way up. So it, because of the helix, it's a gradual engagement along that one tooth. Also, what is very interesting in helical enamelling is because of this helix, if this tooth, so let's assume this is in contact right now. At this point, the immersion angle, the engagement angle we spoke about, is say phi. But you can see that because there is a helix, this point, if it is cutting at say a millimeter deep, this point is going to lag. So it's going to be, in time scale, it is going to be behind the bottom tooth. Are you understanding? So you're cutting like this. At zero, at the bottom, immersion angle is say 90 degrees. But because there's a helix, by the time you come up, that angle is different. And that's called a lag angle. And lag angle is, this is nothing but geometry. This is beta is this, tan beta is, oh sorry, psi is the lag angle. And if you take tan of this angle, is nothing but O upon A, and O is nothing but diameter divided or radius into this angle, and that will give you what, and Z is actually the depth of cut. So A is normally what we think the depth of cut, but for our purposes now we'll define Z as a depth of cut, and we'll tell you why. Because it keeps changing as a function of helix. So this is very difficult to understand, but let's try. Is this, so when the tooth is at the bottom, the immersion angle will be something, but when the tooth is at the top, so because of the helix, the engagement is going to be different, and there's going to be a lag. So it's going to be in time scale behind, because you're also rotating, right? Okay, so two very interesting things that happen in helical end milling. There's a gradual change in chip thickness, as well as a lag. And also what is interesting is, I think I already spoke about this, is when, let's go back, is when this bottom is at 0.5. If you remember what phi was, is the immersion angle. So let's look at that face mill view again. And say we have one tooth here, two, three, and four. And say we are cutting this workpiece. This is rotating like this. When this tooth is here, this is the engagement angle. In this case, it is 0 degrees. But now there is a helix. So the point at the bottom and at any given point along the axial or the axis of this cutter, it is going to be different. So phi was, or let's say this is phi for this tooth. So phi for this tooth at the bottom and phi for this tooth along the helix is different. There's a lag. And that lag is shown over here by psi. Psi is what is the lag angle. Okay, now there are multiple teeth, again like we did in milling. So each tooth is going to be at a different immersion angle. So tooth 1 is at 0, for example, tooth this is at 90 degrees, 180, 360. And each of them is going to have a function of lag. The first one, iska, will be 0 and some lag. Second one will be, again, some immersion and then some lag. So it keeps changing dynamically as a function of rotation and as a function of axial depth of cut. And Z is the arbitrary axial depth of cut. So this is what this is showing here. Phi is the immersion angle, now as a function of Z. Z is this arbitrary axial depth of cut. So phi was the immersion. Here this is for different tooth, the pitch angle. And this is the lag angle. So a little more different than face milling. And why it has become different than face milling is because of helix. And helix brings a lag. Any questions there? I know this is difficult, yeah, but use your imagination. There is a lag. Okay, so now the chip thickness. Earlier, it was only a function of C and sine phi. Now, it's a function of C, sine phi, but at a particular actual step. Yeah? Because at each point, it is going to be different. Earlier, it was very simple, straight teeth, no? So C sine phi. But now, it becomes C sine and a function of actual depth of cut. That's why you can see phi in turn is a function of Z. Clear? Okay. Z is this actual depth of cut. We calling this A, this can be Z. Okay. So along Z, if it is at this point, yeah, if this is your Z, this much, yeah, so you'll calculate your feed at each different point as a function for this maximum Z. If you change Z, because of the helix, your feed will be different. Okay.
But wouldn't there be two cutting edges at some point in the economic set because of the second tooth coming in again?
Yes. So that's why it's a summation over multiple teeth. This is for one tooth. J is a subscript for one tooth. J, H, J, that means H, 1. Yeah? And then we sum them over all teeth again, like we did in face milling. Yeah? So we calculate for each tooth individually first. And then we see how many teeth are in contact and then sum them together. Okay, moving on. So like I already said, yeah, this perhaps might make it clearer. So,
the drawing doesn't say
so. It doesn't make it clearer. Okay, anyway, the idea is to try and make it clearer. My point was that the chip thickness now is a function not only of feed, engagement, but also a function of Z. Yeah? And now perhaps you can see, yeah? So this point in cut and this point in cut, because of the helix, yeah? You can see this point is behind this. This will first cut, this will cut later. You can see as this is rotating, this is cutting first, this is cutting later. And this is what I mean by lag. So this point is lagging this by a certain angle or time as a function of rotation. So is that clear? Anyway, okay, so because it lags, what happens is it is different along all, along the entire axis. So you really can't do it in one go. You need to discretize it along elements. So you can see these are, for example, sample forces. You can see that force at this actual depth of cut is different. This full thing is in contact, but at this level, the force is different as compared to the force at this level. So if you want to analyze the force along the full engagement or depth of cut, you need to discretize your cutter into steps. So if it's say 10 millimeter, you can discretize these 10 millimeters into 300 steps or 1000 steps depending on how resolution you want. Because it keeps changing. So that's what we do. If you remember these forces earlier, same forces we have now. Earlier we just dropped this differential element, yeah, D. This is looking familiar, right? Ye pehle dekha tha. Same thing. So earlier we had just Ft was a function of K. Let me write that. I think it will be easier. So earlier we had Ft was KTC B of H phi plus KTE B, right? Now what you see is happening is, actually we'll call it A, because we're using A, right? Okay. This is the same thing. But instead of A, we have dz. Yeah? This is also dz. So dz, dz. And what is happening is because it's changing as a function of z, yeah? this becomes a function of phi as well as z. Earlier this was only phi. But here, now this phi will become a function of phi and z. Phi and z. Many is many, sorry. Right? Yes. Yeah, this will also become a function of phi and z. And then this will become d. And that's what we are doing. Okay? A is here, A has to go out. Yeah? Then it will become dz. Okay? But that's what we did. Did you follow what we did? Is because h is a function of phi as z, we just discretized it into small elements. And we now we have forces at each element as a function of dz. It is 3D because of helix, yeah. And it complicates things, makes it very interesting, yeah. You can see. And not only 3D, changing as a function of, it was only rotation, right, in face milling. Now it's a function of rotation as well as level, actual level. Yeah. Okay, so we can get these forces like we got earlier. If we get these coefficients like we got for face milling, same coefficients for end milling. Or identify them for face end milling. The immersion angle we already defined, yeah, is a function of the engagement. J is the counter for number of teeth. So first tooth, phi p is the pitch angle, and this is the lag angle. So this goes inside this. Yeah? So it becomes a very interesting expression. So this is equation A, equation B, two things you need to remember, and then equation C, which is x, y, z. So like we did earlier, we resolved components into x and y. The same thing we did here, tangential, radial, axial, resolve them in x, y, z. Okay, it's the same idea. The only thing that is different is it's changing as a function of immersion, engagement, and a function of axial step. Okay, Abhishek agrees. Time for a video after this. We'll have plenty of videos after this. Yeah? Okay. I just have a couple more slides, then we'll do some animations, simulations. So these are the three equations I'm repeating. What is important to remember is this changes as a function of z and engagement. This is the tangential radial axial. This is x, y, z. Yeah? So feed, normal, and axial components. If we substitute A and B, so these two into this, because you see h, we have an expression for h, we have expressions for dft, which is here. So these two go into this. Now you get a very nice complicated looking equation. So this is the force in the x, y, z direction at each axial integration step along that tool. So this is x, y, z forces, which are a function of h, function of coefficients, function of engagement, and function of axial step, so wherever it is in contact. Now this is very difficult to solve. This is for one. So the dx, f, y, z is for one element here. Yeah? One element. Like this, you'll have, depending if you discretize this into 1,000 steps, you will have 1,000 elements. So we are calculating this for one element. It will change depending on z. So if you change z here, everything changes. If you change phi, everything changes. So you have to recalculate this for every phi and z. So one way is you can do analytical integration. So this is a discrete element. You can integrate this within limits. But this is a very long form expression. If we try and derive it together, it will take us 3 hours. So we'll avoid this. Yeah? But if you're interested, we can talk about it later. What we instead do is we do numerical simulation. Yeah? Simpler as compared to analytical. There's a closed form solution for this. Yeah? So people who like nice analytical clean solution, there's a closed form solution for getting these forces. So this is integrating for between Z1 and Z2 steps for each tooth, and this is x, y, z. So q is the index for x, y, z. Yeah? It's written there. One way is analytical, second is numerically. This is in a way numerical integration, no? You're summing over all elements. So you calculate for each element, you take the next element where phi and z are different, you recalculate, and then you sum all of them for each tooth and you get the complete force profile. This is just single integration because it's a function of step. Phi is already inside this. Phi information is already here. This is as a function of every step. So between, so this is your, say your engagement is so much, and you discretize this into 100 elements. So for each element is what you're calculating, and then you integrate it all. Okay, any question? Okay, so we'll do numerical simulation. So this is a numerical pseudocode. This is from a book by Professor Altintosh. I think somebody here has a copy. Professor Yusuf Altintosh. I did my PhD with him. He's the guru of all gurus in machines and machining and tools and dynamics and control. But there's a very nice, in fact, this is the book. So this is first edition. I'm not advertising it, but it's a very handy reference to have. You can take a look later. So this is a pseudo code that he has prepared to simulate these forces. So I'll just first talk you through the code and then we'll implement it in MATLAB and we'll change parameters and we'll see what happens. So your animation is coming in 2 minutes. Okay, so what is input? We want forces as output. Forces, torque, power is what we want as output. What is input? So input is cutting conditions. What is your depth of cut? What is your feed rate? What is your spindle speed? What is your engagement? So is it up milling, down milling? Is it slotting? Is it face milling? What is your entry angle? What is your exit angle? This you have to tell us at the beginning, right? So these are the inputs. Also input is tool diameter, number of teeth, and helix angle, beta. Beta is the angle of helix. Also input is cutting force coefficients. We already spoke about these, right? I don't know if this is clear, but there's KTC, KRC, and so on. Also input is integration angle. So from 0 to 360 degrees, how many steps you want to take. And there's an integration height, so that from A, delta A is how many steps that you want. So this is input into this. We want to solve this equation. No, delta phi is for integration from 0 to 360. This is a continuous integral, right? So it doesn't need d phi because it's already inside this. But now we're doing numerical. And phi is already here as a function of z. So we have to bring it there somehow. Okay. So again, repeating inputs is axial depth of cut, feed, C, N is spindle speed, phi start, phi exit, engagement conditions. D is diameter, N is number of teeth, beta is helix angle. These are cutting force coefficients, these are integration steps for immersion, engagement, as well as axial. Outputs are Fx, Fy, Fz, what we want, and also power and torque. So what we first do, pseudo code, we'll just talk you through this, then we'll do the, is we define cutter pitch. So we know number of teeth, we know phi, we define pitch, we define number of angular integration steps. So from 0 to 360, how many steps do you want, discretize, the finer the better. Number of axial integration steps, so along Z1 to Z2, which is the engagement, how many steps do you want. And then we start the numerical loop. So from I equal to K, where K is the number of angular integration steps. So for each angle, H is equal to C sine phi. So for each phi, delta phi, we'll first calculate what the immersion at the bottom is. Then we'll calculate what we'll initialize force, so all forces are first zero. Then we'll say, what is the contribution from number of teeth? How many teeth are in cut? Then we'll decide what the immersion angle for every tooth is. Then we'll decide, okay, integrate along each actual depth of cut for that tooth. Because it says 5 millimeters, 5 millimeters you divide by 100 elements. So for one engagement, for how many of a tooth are in contact between that entry and exit, you calculate for each axial step and axial position. So you have the lag angle, you calculate forces. Yeah? This is the force that we saw earlier. KTC, KAC, KRC A is the axial depth of cut. And you store that and you sum the forces over each tooth, and then you loop back, you index it by one more degree. H equal to C sine phi, you change phi, then you change Z, you calculate all this again. And you do this for every tooth, and then you sum them all together and you see what your force profile looks like. So that is what we'll do now. Yeah? So we'll take some inputs from you, whatever parameters you like, and I've already coded this up, we won't do this together. And we'll see what force profile looks like. This is our case study part of it. Okay, any questions? Okay, so this is I'll just talk you through the code. So like I said, material specification. Is it clear to people at the back? Or should I zoom? I don't know how to zoom in this, I've never done zoom. No, there is no zoom in this actually. Kisme? Anyway, chalo, this zoom doesn't matter. If you can't find it, it doesn't matter. Okay, what we want to do is define material properties. So we said earlier that each material and tool has a specific cutting constant. So this is for aluminium, 750 Newton per millimeter square. This is the tangential, this is the feed one, radial. Yeah? And this is for one kind of aluminium, you change the aluminium, this will be different. We define cutting parameter, which was an input, depth of cut, feed, speed, omega is the speed. We define tool parameters, which is diameter, helix, and number of teeth. Then we'll define up milling or down milling, so, and what the engagement is in each case. And then these are the simulation parameters we spoke about here. Number of steps, number of time steps, number of angular steps, and number of axial steps. And then we calculate this. So this is calculating force over each. I'll skip all this, this is a lot of, there's no point getting into code. But the idea is what we are doing at the end is we are getting force in X and Y. We can also get resultant if you want. I'm not interested in calculating it, so I've not put it here. And then we can plot what the forces are as a function of tooth angle. Yeah? So let us do that. Yeah?
So this program exists?
Yes, yes, go ahead.
This program, can you make one?
Bolo. No, no, this program is just to show you how forces look. If you know K.
How you are explaining the forces, addition of those things, is there any do we have a writing coding on that equation? Or
which equation?
For every step.
Yeah, yeah.
It includes the lag angle.
Yes, all this is here. No, KT, KTER. No, is there no? KT and KN are there. So these are the material constants, right? You mean these, right? KTC, KAC. Ye jo hai, these are specific cutting coefficients. Yeah? These go into calculation, you can see they're here. Okay. FT and FN, if I want to find tangential and normal force. Can you see KT is a function here? Huh?
But the rubbing one? What?
No, rubbing we've ignored. Yeah? Edge coefficients I've ignored here. But I can include. I just need to modify this. Yeah? This force, I'll add an edge coefficient. I've not put it in here right now, but I can. Yeah? In fact, we'll do that. Let's run it without it. Yes. So KTC is a specific cutting constant and KTE is the edge constant. So let's do one thing. Yeah. Let's run it without the edge. Then let's add the edge coefficient and see what happens. Yeah. So let's do that. No, then you see the difference of edge. Yeah. Okay, so this is a very old laptop. So okay, so what would you like? Up milling or down milling? Okay, so we'll do up milling. So what kind of engagement do you want? So in terms of diameter, should the phi be 10% of the diameter, 20%, 30%? Slotting we'll forget. Let's do half immersion. 50%. Yeah? So okay, half immersion is two input, okay? All right, so this is how our forces look. So this is up milling, F, X and Y. If you remember the force profile, you can see that up milling gradually increases, then it falls. Again gradually increases, then it falls. Now if you repeat the same thing, you can remember this image. Oh, let me save it. Up 50, right? Now let's run this program again for down milling. And you can then compare force profiles also. So down milling for half immersion. And let's open the other one. Okay. So the left one is down milling, the right one is up milling. You can see the force profile is very different. All that we did is just changed up to down. Yeah? This is for aluminium, 7075 approximately. The force for up milling is about, in the y direction is greater, maximum is about 480 Newton. Yeah? Now let's change the material. Yeah? Let's make it steel. Let's see what happens to forces. Yeah? We would expect it to increase. Yeah? So the idea for this code is to help you appreciate just, this is the same pseudocode I showed you earlier. This is just coded up in MATLAB. Yeah? If we change this to steel, yeah? So what will change is material specification. The steel is about 2800. And this is about 1000. Yeah? So let's do up milling because we've saved that figure. Okay, you can see the force level. Its force profile is the same. Only thing that has changed is force level. Yeah. Now you want to add edge coefficient, right? So let's add edge coefficient and see what happens. So let's call it KTE. Yeah? 200. Normally edge coefficient is at least one order of magnitude smaller than main coefficient. So we assume 200, we're just seeing some value. Yeah? And we'll need to change this thing here, right? KTE. What did we call it? KTE. KTE into DB. So we'll go back to aluminium because we have saved that, what was it, 750 and 250. Okay, then let's, no, this is too much then, let's make this 50. Yeah. So we'll do this for up milling, half immersion, so 50%, and we'll compare it with the saved figure. So up milling and half immersion. Okay, now let's put this here and let's open up this. So on the right is without edge coefficient, on the left is with edge coefficient. So you can see, obviously, because you have one more component in the force, it increases. But it doesn't change profile, it just changes amplitude. Good? So this is a simple MATLAB code. What I would also like to show you is a cutting process simulation code. So this is called CutPro. CutPro is again by Professor Altintosh. So their lab has developed a nice virtual machining simulation code where you can simulate whatever you want. So your question was about what happens to feed and surface roughness. So we can predict that now with and without tool vibration. So let's do 2.5 axis milling. So we're going to do milling process simulation. We will input. This is what we want to output. Cutting forces, tool vibrations, workpiece vibrations, surface finish, spindle power and torque, spindle bending moment, how the chip thickness changes as a function of engagement. All this you can calculate. The MATLAB code can also calculate it. We've just taken the MATLAB code, cleaned it up, made a nice GUI. This is what you get. Okay, so we need to define input parameters. So what kind of tool would you like to play with? This is up to you. So what it is asking is a cylindrical end mill, ball end mill, general end mill. Very difficult. Let's keep it simple. Cylindrical end mill. Okay. How many teeth do you like? 4, 8, 10? 4? Okay. Uniform pitch. You can also do non-uniform pitch in this. So if the pitch is not 90 degrees, you can do non-uniform and see what happens. You can also do that in the MATLAB thing, is not very difficult. Okay, what is the tool diameter you would like? 16? Okay, very good. You can define tool overhang, first bearing position, because this will define your bending moment and how things will deflect. So all this you can input over here. Okay, so diameter, and these are tool parameters. You can also define geometry of tool. You can see there's taper angle, relief angle, rake angle, everything is here. So everything that you get from a milling product catalog for a tool, you can put here. So spindle overhang, the tool overhang from the first bearing position. This you know in the machine, right? So if it's a long tool, it'll be more. For a short tool, it'll be less. So, okay, so we define all these parameters. Now you can define if the machine model is rigid or flexible. So everything we've been doing till now, orthogonal, oblique, and even milling, is all for static, rigid. In reality, everything is flexible. But flexibility you can understand when you first understand what is happening in simple case. So we'll take rigid, and then we'll make it flexible. We'll see what happens there also. This is your question. Chip model, should it be approximation or should it be exact kinematics? So what we've been talking about is when the C moves, if you remember that HC sine phi, this is an approximate model. The exact kinematics is a closed form solution, but it is available, it is already coded up. We can compare both actually, we'll do that also. Okay, so let's first take approximate. What kind of workpiece material would you like to cut? There is a database of 500 materials in all this, where all these coefficients have already been identified. It's a lot of work. There are about, you can see, 5-8 types of aluminium. There's titanium, there's steel, different DIN standard materials, different AISI standards. So everything is here. You can select material. And each time you select a material, its coefficient will be different. So whose question was it that you can do orthogonal to oblique transformation? So we can see what kind of, this is, sorry. So let's assume 7075 aluminium. No, let's take 6061. So aluminium 6061. We can see what the cutting force model was. Cutting coefficients. So this is, you can see, this is a complex equation. That means it was, cutting force coefficients were identified in orthogonal tests and then transformed using the geometry of this tool to oblique, to milling. So this is happening internally in the code. You can also just, this is the transformation. You can also, 7075 I believe is, cutting coefficients are just numerical values which you identified in input. For example, your material that we will cut tomorrow is, we are calling law. Yes. Yes. So, for example, this material is what we are cutting, aluminium. We are calling this law IITK. So, this is what we identified using experiments. You can add, you can edit. So, it's a database. Yeah? Open source is MATLAB code. No, I gave you the code. You can run it. No, I think this is a lot of development work which has gone into making this. Okay, so let's assume we're cutting aluminium 60-61. Yeah? Approximate kinematics. Sometimes even the workpiece can be flexible. Not only the tool, if you're doing very thin wall machining like the turbine blade that we showed you, even that is flexible. So you can also put its dynamics here, but we're assuming rigid right now, big block of workpiece. Yeah? Chip model is approximate. What are the cutting conditions? So there is slotting, up milling, down milling. We can define what you want to do. So what would you like to do? Down milling. Okay, let's do down milling. What kind of engagement? Entry, exit. So this is 50% you can see right now. Yeah? You can define feed in millimeter per tooth. RPM, spindle speed, actual depth of cut, and then these are simulation parameters. Yeah? Okay, so this is it. We can also do temperature, but we're not interested in it. And we just run the code, it takes 5 seconds. And now let's plot first. Sorry, we didn't want to plot everything. Okay, let's plot cutting forces in x, y, z. Yeah? So this is a function of time, forces in the y-axis. Yeah? And let's just zoom to see the profile. Yeah? So this is down milling. The profiles make sense. Yeah? For the y direction, x and z is always different. Yeah? But y will give you a nice indication whether it's up or down. So you can see it's down milling, gradually decreasing. We can also predict how the chip thickness changes. So let's look at that. Yeah? So because we have this changing as a function of phi, you can see that the chip thickness for each flute, it's a four teeth cutter, four flutes. Each flute is a different color, 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes, because we've defined the engagement condition, right? So it's going to be the same for every. But what you can see, there is an overlap between two teeth. Yeah? Can you see that? Yeah? So when one tooth is getting over, the next one is starting to cut. Okay, so you can do that. You can also then, so once you have forces, you can also get.
Cutting forces, both Fx and Fy are functions of Shannon force. Why is it very obvious in Fx, the down milling signature, and not in Fy?
For that you need to look at this equation. Actually, no, let's look at, here you can see it. Yeah? You can see x, y, z is a function of t, r, n, a. So, x, y, z is a function of tangential as well as radial. Yeah? Y is a function of tangential as well as radial. Yeah? And tangential and radial are in turn function of different things. Yeah. So, it depends on what is happening here. Is how you will simulate this. Yeah?
No, the signature was obviously only one of them.
Yes, because it depends on how the chip is forming. So, you mean down milling? So, this signature, this, it's different, yes? It's different is because how the chip formation takes place. So, it is most obvious actually in the resultant force. So, if you look at resultant force in the xy plane, you can see this is the down milling profile in the resultant. But each component is different. Okay, so we were looking at spindle power. So, zoom. So, we're cutting aluminium. So, the red is the average power. 3.5 kilowatt is understandable for aluminium. the depth of cut was 5 millimeter, 5000 rpm. So you can see everything that we've done till now, you can code up either in MATLAB or you can use something like this. You can play with parameters and you can see what happens. So now we did approximate kinematics. Yeah? Let's make exact kinematics and see what happens to chip thickness profile. Yeah? So I'll only keep that plot open. Yeah? No. This is developed by. You have to buy it. I'm just showing you, see, it makes, because instead of, I have MATLAB codes for everything that we're talking about, but this is easier to show you because you can do everything very nice interface. You can write your own MATLAB code and do everything. So now let's change chip model to exact. Exact kinematics. Everything else is the same. Let me just run this again. Okay, so first let's, so Harsha, this was your question. So this is the approximate chip kinematics, chip thickness. If you look at chip thickness in exact, which is this plot, it's not very different. You can see, left, right. So it's not so different. Is what my point is. So the approximate is a fairly reasonable approximation. Amplitude should be the same. So this is 0.2 is maximum, and this is exactly more. So FFT will show you what? Tooth passing frequency, spindle frequency. So there is spindle frequency and tooth passing frequency, two concepts. So in turning, there is only one frequency, which is rotational frequency. So if it is 6000 RPM, it is how many hertz? So one cycle per second is 1 hertz. Yeah? So it's 6000 RPM, 100 hertz. Yeah? In turning, so it's the rotational frequency. In milling, you have something called tooth passing frequency. So in one rotation, how many times does the tooth pass? So FT is equal to spindle frequency times number of teeth. So in milling, if your speed is 5000 RPM, what frequency will you see if you have four teeth? So 5000 divided by 60 into 4. So kitna hota hai, koi karega? So 5000 divided by 60 into 4, 333 hertz is what you should see. So if you look at the FFT of that cutting signal, is you should see 333 hertz. But we don't. What are we seeing? So we are seeing, this is called, this is the harmonic, this is the fundamental frequency. How do I put a 84 into the 4 is approximately 333. This is the fundamental frequency, and then there are four frequencies. So chip thickness is not a good thing to see. Let's see cutting force. 1 minute. Cutting force. Okay. So this is, you should see 333 hertz is what we are seeing. Zoom here. Let's make this full. So this is 333 hertz is what you should see. That was chip thickness calculation, there's something else. Yeah? The forces, they would look at frequency in the force content, not chip thickness. Yeah? So this is the frequency you see. Good. Any questions? Huh? Kyun? Aapko good nahi laga? This is happening for you. Any questions? Yeah? So I know we've had a lot of information today. Yeah? We've gone from overview of what machining dynamics is, to what orthogonal cutting is, to what oblique cutting is, to the complicated milling processes. Okay, thank you. I had presentation in the morning also. Which one do you mean? Okay. All right, so good. Well, that is our purpose, yeah, is to introduce to you, and hopefully you appreciate and take something back with you. So, any further questions, or can we conclude for today and meet tomorrow? Yeah? Why don't you simulate and see? So, if you remember, the first simulation was up milling. Yeah? Let's make the helix 0. So, gamma is equal to 0. So, straight teeth. Yeah? So, up milling, half immersion, so 50% engagement. Yeah? So, this is 700. Oh, it's sorry, yes, it has got KTE. Let's remove KTE. KTE ko 0 kar do. Okay, and let's open the up milling 50. And this is here. So, what does it really do? Straight teeth should have higher forces, and it has a little higher force, and you can see the effect mostly in Fy, not so much in Fx. For aluminium, yeah. You change the material, you see what will happen. You change engagement, it will be even more different. Yeah. Good. All right. So. In the milling, there is no cutting at the bottom in end mills. The kind of cutting in the bottom is talking about plunge milling. So, it's a very different kind of geometry. Yeah. One which cut at the bottom, for example, if you take an end mill can only do shoulder milling. So, this kind of milling. Yeah. It cannot cut at the bottom. Plunge milling cutters can cut at the bottom, but they have a very different tooth profile. So, in that case, your kinematics will be different, your mechanics will be different. Yeah. The way you will discretize will be different. We're talking about where? No, no. The four tooths are along the periphery. He's talking about maybe the lip at the bottom of the tool. Is that what you're interested in? Yes. So if I understand your question correctly, you're asking, ye jo cutter hai, this has got teeth only on the periphery, not at the bottom. It's not cutting in the bottom. No, it is cutting along, so there are four teeth, it's got four cutting edges. If you want two teeth cutter, it will have two cutting edges. What we are looking at right now is four teeth, for example. Yeah? Is that what your question is? Yeah? So, number of cutting edges depending on number of teeth. And this is only cutting on the periphery. If you remember the first slide I showed you, there are some cutters which have some very interesting geometry. जैसे ये जो है देर इज इज प्लंज मिलिंग ये वाला जो है प्लंज दिस इज कटिंग एट द बॉटम ऑल्सो एज वेल एज ऑन द साइड दिस इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट एंड कॉम्प्लिकेटेड सो वी हैव लेफ्ट दिस आउट ओनली टॉकिंग अबाउट सिंपल टुडे ओके वी कैन कंटिन्यू द कॉन्वर्सेशन इफ देर आर क्वेश्चन आउट साइड अदरवाइज आई होप यू हैड अ लॉन्ग एंड इट्स बीन अ लॉन्ग डे आई नो बट आई होप इट्स बीन प्रोडक्टिव एंड टुमारो वी विल स्टार्ट विद डायनेमिक्स So we'll start with how things vibrate, how you model them, and tomorrow afternoon we'll have a lab session. So tomorrow morning is only dynamics, first two sessions. Everybody has a schedule. And afternoon we'll talk about